Greetings, brothers and sisters. We welcome you to our worship service. I'm Pastor Kenneth A. Staples of the Good Shepherd Missionary Baptist Church here in Southgate, Michigan. We pray that you will come in, worship with us, and just have a wonderful, blessed time in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ.
Thank you.
service on this morning. We're going to go right into the Word of God on today. Scripture will be taken from Psalm 42, verses 1 through 4. Psalm 42, verses 1 through 4. And while you're looking for that, we want to say Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. We truly thank God for all the mothers, and truly it does no justice for us to celebrate mothers only one day out of the year, but moms ought to be celebrating every day. So once again, mothers, we thank God for each and every one of you, because without you, there would be no us. So we thank God for you. So if you would turn to Psalm 42, and I'm going to pull one additional passage of scripture to help me with what I'm going to talk about on today. Exodus chapter 32 and verse 26. Amen. Psalm 42. And it says, as the hart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. My soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my meat day and night, while they continually say unto me, where is thy God? When I remember these things, I pour out my soul in thee. For I had gone with the multitude, I went with them to the house of God, with the voice of joy and praise, with the multitude that kept holy day. Exodus 32 and verse 26. That a portion. Then Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, who is on the Lord's side? Let him come unto me. God bless your house. I want to talk to you today from the mindset of searching for hope. Question I'm going to try to answer is, where shall we find it? Searching for hope, where shall we find it? And the reality of this Christian walk, I've discovered that even Christians can become depressed and despondent and discouraged and have a disdained attitude while traveling this Christian journey. And if we can be real, I believe that we ought to be real one with another. If we can be real with each other on today, and get out of the falsity of religiosity and really get down to the crux of the matter and be real, the reality of the world of which we live in, yes, even the blood-washed saint can become depressed. We just need to be real about it. Even the blood-washed saint can be to the point where they're at their last straw, don't know which way to go, don't know which way to turn, but even the blood-washed saint that he is can come to the point of being dejected. And when we get to that point, we, even the body of believers, are in need of something. And I believe that each and every one of us woke up this morning and we're looking for something. I believe that each and every one of us who tuned in to have service with us on this morning, you woke up because you were looking to hear something from the Lord. When we look at life's affairs and see the devastation and the unimaginable things that have been taking place within the confinement of the earth's realm, we can become despondent. And with so much trouble and death and turmoil and tragedies, I believe that many of us can become numb to life circumstances. Simply because of the frequency and the careless actions of some, and just by the whole totality of what's going on, and now several weeks into the pandemic that it's called, it seems that it doesn't shake us now the way it once did. And really, when you think about things that don't seem to shake us any longer, even the tragedies and even the violence that goes on in our world, it seems that it doesn't shake us the way it once did. It seems as though now anything now goes. And we really have pressed even the envelope of the reality of now nothing really catches us by surprise. And it just appears as now the abnormal is normality. Yeah, it seems like the thing that really troubled us the most, now it seems as though it's a normal day's walk at the park. Right. Trouble has become now common, and I believe that since trouble is so common with us on today, that now that many of us, we have even stopped praying on a regular basis. Trials are so prevalent that we've really stopped seeking the face of God, because many think that we're in a losing battle. Tribulations are so vast that we've even stopped looking for the hand of God. Stop looking for the hand of God to come in and intervene. I believe that we have become distracted. I believe it was one of my grandbabies who said once before that when it came to their electronic usages, they said that they don't like taking electronic breaks. I believe that we have become so consumed and preoccupied with everything else, but we have stopped coming to the place where we want to spend time and talk with God. Social media, we want to find out what everybody else is doing. We want to know what's going on in everyone else's life. We're caught up on meeting up on social media just for a social kick, and we're living our lives every moment on social instant craze of really who's who and what's what and what you're doing. Because now with the lock-in around the world, you got folk broadcasting social media that is broadcasting in the bedrooms. Now, what in the world sense does that make, that I want to see you talking and broadcasting from your private place? In clothes that are scandalous,
too much going on. I believe I hear in the vernacular of the young people, that too much is going on. Wake up looking at a phone. We wake up going to sleep with a phone in our hand. We wake up, we walk around throughout the day, and everybody's checking social media. At the dinner table, you know, even at the dinner table before this pandemic, you would see folk at the dinner table, and then everybody would be on social media. Thumbs would be working. Or if you're good at it, you just use one thumb, but I gotta use two thumbs when I'm trying to text. Somebody know what I'm talking about. Go to bed checking in. But as a society, we've become sick and we need some help. And not only do we need some help, but we also need some hope. We live in times of sickness. Yes, we live in times of sickness. As a matter of fact, this pandemic, the sickness that's going around, yes, people are physically sick, but also people are mentally sick and also spiritually sick. One writer called these times, he called them perilous times. I believe it was in the book where the Apostle Paul, where he forewarned Timothy that in the last days that there would be difficult times. It was in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 2 where Paul said that in the last days people would love only themselves and their money. They would become boastful and proud and scoffing at God and disobedient to their parents and ungrateful. Yes. Yeah, I believe that we've even become ungrateful to all that God has done. We have forgotten our way to God. We have turned our backs on God. Paul said they will be unloving and unforgiving and they will slander others and have no self-control. That they will be cruel and hate what is good, betray their friends and live reckless and be reckless and be puffed up with pride and love pleasure rather than God. Then he said they would act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. I want to be godly. I don't want to be religious. I want to be God, because God is a holy God, and the people that God are looking for, he's looking for a holy people in times such as these. Searching for the hope, and where shall we find? How long will God, that's a question I want to ask. How long will God allow for trouble and tragedy to happen in this world? How long will God allow for his people to perish at the hands of the ungodly? When will we as believers of God come to the place of seriousness that this is perilous time? Perilous time, perilous times, it really does something to us. Perilous times, it creates a particular posture from the people. Number one, the posture is it causes panting from the people. The psalmist said, as the heart panteth after the water brooks. The heart is fond of feeding near water. When one runs in an attempt to escape capture, that is, you know when you used to watch those movies years ago, and they show someone trying to escape capture, you know, maybe escaping from a jail or escaping from the hand of the enemy. They would look for a body of water to run to. Because what that body of water would do, it would do a couple of things. Number one, what it would do, it would eliminate any trail or scent to throw off the dogs, throw off the bloodhounds that would be on their trail. Secondly, they would also use the water to swim or to float or to hide, you know, to submerge themselves underwater to overt capture. Also in the chase, one becomes faint because you've been running so long. And even in the long run, you can become weary. So when you become faint and weary, they look to the water for refreshment. They look to the water for revivement. They look to the water for replenishment. They look to the water to give them and restore them to a level that they can keep on going just a little while longer. Seeking, thank you for the drink, seeking and searching for the living God. See, when you search for the living God, when you look for the living God, it is the living God that will revive you. It's the living God that will give you that thing that you need when you felt so down, when you felt so low, when you felt so weak. I wonder if there's anybody in here who's ever been to the point that they wanted to give up, that they wanted to throw in the towel, and you looked to your friend and couldn't find one. You called your faith five and you couldn't, or nobody would answer the phone. You wanted to give up, you wanted to jump off the cliff, you wanted to jump over the bridge, but now I tell you, you look for someone. And that someone was God himself, and God came and revived you just in the nick of time. Seeking and searching for God. God has a way of giving us what we need when we need it. So panting. As the heart panteth after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. When the tongue is failing for thirst, as the wild beast, if you will, the wild beast, I like to watch National Geographic, but as the wild beast running out on the tundra or the Sahara Desert, they seek and it pants for the water brooks. But one thing about the water, you gotta be so very careful when you're out in the wild and you go to the water, because predators hang out near the water. Simply because they know that it is the water that will draw prey to the water. Tongue hangs from the side of the mouth dry, seeking the cool, crisp, pure water. When life seems dry, when trouble seems to have wiped you out, you gotta seek the God of heaven. And that's why I like what the word of the Lord said. God said in Isaiah chapter 41 and verse 17, it said, when the poor and needy seek water, and there is none. Because how many of you do know that sometime out in the desert, the water runs out. When the poor and the needy seek the water, and there is none, and their tongue faileth for thirst, I the Lord will hear them. I the God of Israel, hear me now, I the God of Israel will not forsake them. God won't leave us, and he won't forsake us. But we got to get back to the time of old where we look for God. Not only where we look for God, but where we cried out to the God of God. Where we anticipated the hand of God to show up on our behalf. said this the other night on the clarion call. I said that we don't pray much, but we expect all and all from God. Right. Talk about taking prayer out of the schools. Well, children not in school right now. So now we can interject prayer back into the heart, back into the mind of the children. Yes. Now you all gonna pray with me. Yes. That's why I like what Isaiah 41 and 18, God said, I will open rivers in high places and fountains in the midst of the valleys. In other words, God can do the impossible. God can do the unthinkable. If you can call on him, if you can trust in him, he said, I will make wilderness a pool of water, and the dry land springs of waters. In other words, God will give you just what you need, or just what you need in the time of your need. Psalmist says here in the text, there should be a panting after God. Secondly, there should be the pouring of the people of God. Psalm 42 and verse 4, it says, when I remember these things, he said, I pour out my soul in me. Our memories are so short. We have forgotten about all of the hills and all of the mountains that God has brought us over. Matter of fact, God has been so good to us, he has brought us from cotton sacks all the way to Cadillacs. But we have forgotten about what God has done. Yeah. We are short. You know, our memories are very short. Because we always say, what have you done for me lately? But I come back and tell you, if God doesn't do anything else for me, he's already done enough. We get things twisted. We always want to hear and see our names and light. We want to receive accolades, and then we're down when we stop hearing our names called. So happy. Have you ever received a gift? Maybe your spouse gave you a gift, and so happy when you receive that gift, but 3 days later, you're back evil and hard to deal with. My house all right, y'all. Because I get a gift, I put in a closet, I won't do nothing with it for 2-3 years. So I don't worry about no gifts. I'm just trying to tell you, sometimes we can get, we can have false happiness over things that really don't mean anything. Psalmist said, when I remember my tears, when I remember that I cried, my soul takes me back to where the saints gathered and we went to the house of God. And when we went to the house of God, we went in with the voice. And with that voice that we had, there was joy in our voice. There was praise in our joy, because the multitude that came to the house of God, they kept the God's holy day. According to Exodus chapter 23 and verse 17, it said that 3 times in a year, all males shall appear before the Lord thy God. I know it's Mother's Day, but I just want to talk about the brothers, because if the brothers get right, the house will be right and the mothers will be covered. The psalmist said, when the men gathered, the voice was joy and praise. Yeah, I hope I didn't lose no brothers. Y'all hang on with me one more minute. I'm gonna rush on and show you where I'm going with this. The psalmist said, when the men gathered, the voice was joy and praise. All they've been talking about these last several weeks was when sporting events was gone. Come back in session. Because you do know that men, we gather for sporting events, you know, macho, and we shout and we dance and see more men dancing at sporting events and slapping thighs and fist bumping and chest bumping and, you know, even since you've been sitting on the couch so long now, it's belly bumping. But the psalmist says that real men gather at the house of the Lord with the voice of joy, giving God the praise. Yes. Men, if we want to get our houses right, got to be a house of prayer and praise unto God. Number three, we don't need, or what we don't need in the Lord's house is power. And it's right there in the text. It's right there in the text. And you just hang out with me. Psalm 42 verse 5. It's in the text. We don't need power in the Lord's house. He said, why thou cast down, O my soul? And while thou discredited in me. Oftentimes we pout and complain so much that we don't even allow God time to work in our lives. We will shout with the message, like some of y'all shout now. We shout with the message, but as soon after the benediction, we're right back to complaining. Back to the same old way. Back to the same old attitude. Back to the same old thing. But just 10 minutes ago, we were up shouting and snouting all over the place. Yeah. But what I want to encourage you right now, stop pouting. Stop complaining about this, that, and the other. But stop all this complaining. But we need to transfer from where we are and move on so God can use us. What we need to do, number four, is we need to get to the place of praise. Y'all, it's in the text, dude. It's in the text. We need to get to the place, of praise. Verse number 11 said, and I tell you, I think I'll be done now. He said, why have thou cast down, O my soul? Why have thou disquieted it within me? Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him who is the health of my countenance and my God. The psalmist, he had to deal with himself because his soul was so far cast down. He was feeling the blues. And I want to tell you right now, I know you've been locked in. You might as well turn the blues off. Turn muddy waters off. Turn off the blues and turn on a new song. Turn on a song of praise. Psalmist said he was disquieted within himself. In other words, he was going through so much trials and trouble in his life that he was anxious within himself. You know, all this bad news, all this talk about the virus and all this talk about everything else and death and burials and all this. He was anxious. He was uneasy. You know, we so uneasy right now. We so anxious right now. Folk, we don't even want to talk to nobody. Yeah. We don't even greet nobody no more. Ain't no more slapping five and shaking hands and fist bumps. Ain't no more of that right now. It's been 7, 8, 9 weeks of no contact. Son said he was restless. When have you ever had, because of all of your trouble and strife that you've been dealing with, have you ever had some sleepless nights?
Yes.
The psalmist was dissatisfied within himself. But what he did, out of all of his dissatisfaction, he had to shake himself and come to a point in saying, he had to wake himself up, and then he had to say, for I shall yet praise him. No matter what we face in this life, we still need to have a praise. No matter how rough or tough life gets, we still need to praise the Lord. I just wonder if I can get somebody to pray with me this morning. No matter what we have to go through, we ought to be able to give God praise. We need something. My brothers and my sisters, we need something. As a matter of fact, the something that we need is not on Amazon. The something that we need cannot be delivered in a package set on your front porch. But what we need the power and the presence of God to be visible on the inside of us.
Yeah.
Man must know God and know God for himself. And when we think about self, God must exceed all comprehension. Simply because man cannot truly know himself without truly knowing God. When we reflect on God, even in these perilous times, we will know and believe that God is always with his people.
Yes.
Because he said, I just want to encourage you, here's the hope right here. He said that he will never leave nor forsake us. Blessed then is the soul of whom God takes his residence within. If God has taken up residence on the inside of you, you don't have to worry anymore. All you've got to do is trust in God. Blessed is the one who can say, he has formed me. And not only has he formed me, because yes, God has formed us and he knows everything about us. He even knows all the number of hairs on our head, though I need a haircut, yes I do, but God even knows even the number of hairs upon my head. But blessed is the one who can say that yes, he has formed me, yes, he has made me, but yes, he is the one who lodges on the inside of me. He encamps within my tabernacle.
Yeah.
And when God lodges, God Almighty, he brings a whole host of army with him. Yeah, that's why I like what the psalmist said in Psalm 91 verse 11. He said that I will give my angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. In other words, when God dwells on the inside of you, he will bring an army to protect his people. So then what we need to make it through these perilous times is living faith. We really must live what we claim our faith to be. That's why I like what Paul said. Paul said, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. He said, I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. We're living in perilous times. Soon and very soon, my brothers and sisters, the preaching of the gospel will be on. So therefore, we had better catch the word of God. That's when the apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 12, he said, for now we see through a glass, darkly, but then face to face. It's dark out here in this world of which we live, but we need a face-to-face encounter with God. Somebody in this house, your days have been dark. But I come out of Kelly, you can come out of your darkness when you begin to let your troubles go. But then you gotta hold on and you gotta look to God who will strengthen you. So therefore, when you stop worrying about your trouble, but begin to open up your mouth and give God a praise. Yes. Because when you praise God, somehow about praising God in the midst of your stuff, God somehow would make everything feel all right, and somehow you would change your complaint over into looking to the Christ who can do of everything about your problem. And you need a face-to-face with God himself. You know, when we go through dark days and dark patches so long, we start thinking that we need help from other sources. We start taking more pills. We start seeking more medication. We start having more we have more appointments on the couch session where you sit and talk to somebody and they're sitting there doodling, but you pouring out your spirit, and then after 45 minutes they try to tell you what your problem is, and you find out when you leave them, you left off in worse shape than you were when you walked in.
All right.
But I come by to tell you, when you call on God, God will never lead you astray. What we need is a face-to-face with God. What is going on today, the only thing that's going to get us over is God. It's not dependent upon government, not dependent upon political party. It's not dependent upon billions and trillions of dollars. Not dependent upon personalities. It's not dependent upon actors and actresses. But the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 16, it says that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory.
Right.
To be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man. In other words, the heart of man and the soul of man has to desire the true and the living God. On this Mother's Day, mothers need to desire the true and the living God. Babies need to desire the true and the living God. Then the heart and the soul will say that there's something greater inside of you, simply because the Spirit of God has to be inside of you. When we have the Spirit, then the Word of God will come alive in our lives. And you will know that you can do all things through Christ. And when you know that you can do all things through Christ, because it is Christ who gives you the strength. But the strength must come from down on the inside. The strength that we need today is, watch this, the strength that we need today is not by dumbbell, or it's not by the equipment, heavy equipment that you might have in your room, but the equipment that you need is mind over matter.
All right.
No matter what we're facing in life, we must have this resolve. And the resolve that we must have is, I will trust in the Lord. I will not lean upon my own understanding. Because sometimes I just don't understand. Don't understand why God allows some things to happen. Don't understand why why babies have to die. Don't understand why mothers seem to have their way with children and women. Don't understand how it seems as though evil seems to be all around us, and it seems that evil seems to be catching or running ahead of us. But I will not lean into my own understanding, but I will trust in the Lord with all my heart. Because I believe it was God who said, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Yeah. So when I trust God, even in perilous times, I've got to trust God. Yeah. When I trust God, even when faced with troubles, I've got to trust God. When will you trust God? You got to trust God even when evil is present all around me. And when evil is present all around you, you got to walk by faith. Yeah. And because of my faith, I want to please my God. That's why Paul said in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 17, he said that Christ may dwell. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. That ye being rooted and grounded in love. Verse 18, he said, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height. Sometimes I don't understand why things happen the way it does. That's why I need God in my life. When I don't see love even in my own brothers and my own sisters, I need to know the love of Christ. Verse 19 says, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Moses said in Exodus chapter 33 and verse 13, he said that I pray thee if I have found grace in thy sight. He said, show me now thy way. One thing about it, God, we need you to show us the way that we ought to go. He said that I may know thee, that I may find grace in thy sight. Everybody in here can stand for a little more grace. Everybody in here can stand for a little more mercy. That's what Paul said. His greatest longing was that he might know him in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 10. But let me try to hurry up and rush on to a close. Packing after God is really knowing God. Pouring your heart out because he is your God. Not pouring or not pouring simply because you're on the winning team. Yeah. Moses asked the question, who is on the Lord's side? Yeah. He said, let him come unto me. Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. He said, for they shall be satisfied. That was Matthew chapter 5 and verse 6. David said, as the deer pants for the water brook, so my soul pants for you, O God. Yeah. Moses, Paul, David, and Jesus, they all said the same thing when you take time and look at it. God only feeds hungry people. If you're hungry, ask God for spiritual food. Yeah. When God serves at the table, he's saying, come on and eat it up. Yeah, I'm reminded as a boy, as a child, I would go over, my brother and I, we would go over to Uncle Lee's house, and Uncle Lee, he would take us out and go on job sites. We were at 6, 7, 8 years old, we would go out on job site. Let me just kind of paint a picture of who Uncle Lee was. Uncle Lee was your elder uncle who always drove a nice Cadillac. But in a nice Cadillac, he would have on his double reed jeans and a white t-shirt. That's all he had on. Every day you saw him, he had on double reed pants and white t-shirt. t-shirt because he would go to work and then he would go to the racetrack. But what he did here, he would, when we go over to his house, we would have to go to work first. It didn't matter if we were at Harper Hospital throwing garbage, you know, throwing garbage over in a garbage truck or going and hanging and carrying drywall and putting drywall up in buildings. But then after a long, hard day's work, Uncle Lee would take us down to the Eastern Market. And when he went to the Eastern Market, he would get a pound of cheese. He would get a pound of ham. He would get a pound of bologna. He would get a pound of turkey. And he would get some nice soft rolls and some nice hard bread, depending on which a fancy was. And we would go back home and everybody would wash their hands and make a sandwich. But after he ate the first sandwich, you know, growing boys, you always want another sandwich. And you would go in there and ask Uncle Lee, can we have another sandwich? Uncle Lee would say, let me tell you, we went and worked hard all day, and we went and bought meat and bread and cheese and came back home and enjoyed ourselves because we worked hard. He said, that's what it's in there for. He said, it's in there for you to go and get it and eat it up. Say with me, I'm trying to go somewhere with this. The psalmist is saying, get hungry for the Lord. Get thirsty for God. Quit playing God and quit playing God and get on a steady diet with the Lord. Some words he's saying, you gotta get real with God. So in other words, he's saying, you gotta check yourself. So the question is, who is on the Lord's side? Amidst this present trouble, amidst this present confusion, amidst the difficult days, amidst the political posture, amidst trouble on every hand, the question is, who's willing to stand for the Lord? And I hear and I see what the psalmist said in Psalm 42 and verse 1. It says, as the heart panteth, who's tired of scheming? Who's tired of thinking and dreaming? Fake dreams is when you make stuff up and because you're not willing to work hard at it and making the dream come true. You do know David, he was second king in the greatest king of Israel. He was an ancestor of Jesus Christ, of the tribe of Judah, born in Bethlehem of Jesse. His youngest boy, David, was a shepherd boy with great courage and faithfulness. David, who killed a lion and bear, who attacked the flock. I wonder, are there any courageous folk in the house today whose courage is strong in serving the Lord? Faithful in your deportment, willing to stand and fight against the lion of life, because this is a lion that we're facing. Who's willing to do all that you can to book with the adversary? I know we talk a good game, but I don't need Monday morning quarterbacks to get out here. I need somebody to get out here on the gridiron now and grind. Because baby, I tell you, this is the time where we gotta grind. But what are you talking about? We gotta go down on our knees and pray. We gotta go down on our knees and sincere prayer. We gotta get to the point now that we're studying. We ought to be studying our word. We ought to be filling up on the word of God. We ought to be saying, Lord, I thank you, Lord. Lord, I love you. Lord, we need you, Lord. Lord, we pray that you bring us from this day to the next day. I'm reminded my baby, she had on the wall, she had a picture that was painted. And the painting on the picture said, you gotta grind every day. I come out and tell you, life is a grind. And seeking God is a thirst. Seeking God is not only a thirst, but seeking God is a pain. David, the sweet psalmist said, David, the killer of the giant, the Philistine named the night, David, even the fugitive, running for his life after Saul wanted him dead. Some of us are those, beginning to feel just a little bit better now. So as we go with me, as we enter into the experience of a grateful, gracious Saint Bernard on the road of life. Because I believe that mothers know what I'm talking about. Even in childbearing, you know, when you're in the pains of labor. I don't know how that feels, but mothers, you know how child labor pains feel. But after you have delivered the baby, you have forgotten about all the pain that you have gone through, because now you see this beautiful bundle of joy. So now I'm wondering, is there anybody who now, through all the pains of life, through all the treacheries of society, all the afflictions that you had to deal with, battered sometimes, yes, confused sometimes, yes, dismayed sometimes, yes, empty sometimes, yes, falling off by the wayside, yes, but now is the time to get on the Lord's side. It's something in spite of life's trouble when you can come to this resolve as the writer and choose to sing a song lifting the name of the living God. It's dangerous when a child of God is so far down in the dump that you can't even muster up even a song. When in trouble, you gotta find you a song of praise to sing. When you know without a shadow of a doubt you've been preserved, because you don't deserve it, but because of the hand of God, the favor of God, you're here today. You know you haven't been so good, but because of the hand of God, God has preserved you. The hand of God, because of the hand of God, you're saved. Because of the hand of God, you're sound. Because of the hand of God, you're preserved and not spoiled by your sin. And don't get too holy. I see your holy halos. I see your holy halos. You think that's because you've been in the church for 20, 30 years that you haven't sinned? No, baby. The Bible said that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But the only way that you're still here, the only way that I'm still here, is by the sovereign grace of God. That's why I sing with the psalmist. As the heart panteth after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, oh God. I wonder, is there anybody out here with me in the house that's really chasing after God? You know, not playing with God, but you're really chasing after God. And why do I say you're chasing after God? Simply because God is so big. God is so magnanimous. God is so powerful. You can never catch up fully to God. As a matter of fact, God will meet us coming, and God will meet us going. Everywhere we go, God has already beat us there. Are you all going to pray with me? Is there anybody in this house? You're chasing after God. You're searching after God. You're seeking after God. Some of us are like David. We once had that inner peace and relationship with God, but something happened along the way. We lost our fire. We lost our zeal. We lost that oomph down on the inside. Because once you burn with the Spirit of God, you were on fire for the Lord. But something happened. Something happened. And you don't have that same desire. You don't have that same fire. You don't have that same walk. And you don't have that different talk that you once had. Come on and pray with me, somebody. Somebody know what I'm talking about. I'm reminded, I was talking just the other day. Somebody who had just got over the coronavirus 19 and the COVID-19, they said it was tough times, sitting in a room, couldn't eat for 8-9 days, really didn't want to drink, body racking with pain, couldn't move, but I thank God that I made it. But then in the next breath, switch the subject, and subject matter went towards another individual, somebody who had done it wrong just within the hour. Somebody had talked to him the wrong way, and then they began to fight. fire off this word and fire off that word. You know what I'm talking about. Profanity began to fly. Profanity began to sling. You know, one hand you talk about how good God is and how you praise and you worship God. But then in the next breath, you sound like a sinner. You sound like a sinner that has forgotten all about what God just has done. But what I want to tell you today, my brothers and my sisters, don't forget about God. It does not matter what comes up. Stay in tune and stay intact with God. Something happened when your head is hanging low. Just like David now in mourning. But like the reality of the situation didn't call for David to quit. Because David didn't allow the enemy's tactics to overpower him. That's what I want to tell somebody. Don't allow the tactics of the devil to overpower you. He didn't allow the enemies to overpower him. So when he did, he went on patching. That's what we got to do. We got to keep on patting. We got to keep on pressing. We got to keep on pushing. Because the psalmist records his doubts. He records his fears. He records his griefs, which had sorely shaken him. It sorely troubled him. And it sorely troubled and hurt him down to his core. So what I want to tell you is, don't think you got to be Superman or Superwoman. Sometimes in this life, you will get hurt. But the premise is, he looked upon the living God, and he looked upon the living God as the chief good. Come on, we need to look to God, opposed to looking to the bad. And he set his heart upon him accordingly. And he had this resolve. He was resolved to live and not die by him. And casting anchor, thus at first, he rides out the storm in this life. In this life, sometimes you gotta hold on to the storms of life. Sometimes in life, you gotta hold on. When it gets rough and rocky, when trouble rises, you gotta hold on to God. You gotta learn to praise the Lord through your trouble. You gotta learn to praise the Lord in your trouble. You gotta learn to praise the Lord until it brings you out of trouble. Is there anybody in here who has faith? You gotta have faith. Your faith has to be in God. So then we walk by faith. That means the help of faith and not by our sight. Because when you walk by your sight with your sight will tell you that it can't be done. But faith in God will tell you that it can be done. Is there anybody in here that knows that God, the faith in God, it can be done? Faith is the power, realizing of the things looked for, and finding things that not are seen. So here it is in the original text, the song, Psalm 42, the song is in the slang, faith in God. And so he's a seeing the faith in God. He's seeking God's faith, or he's seeking his faith to be in God. And he acknowledges that God is his king. He is the God of his life. In verse number 8, he said that he is the God of his life. But verse number 9, he understands where his power comes from. And he understands the ability to overcome all obstacles. That's why he said that God is his rock. If there ain't anybody in here that know that God is your rock. But verse number 11, he understands that it may be down just for a moment. He might have to go through the struggles of life, but his hope is still in God. I'm trying to take my time in here, and I just want to encourage somebody that your hope has to be in God. Since his hope was in God, this is what he said. He called because the disregard down on the inside of his heart. He puts this to the side. He puts that to the side. But then what he says is, I'm going to praise you. Is there anybody in here that's ready to praise God? Come on to God. And when you come to God with anticipation. But what are you anticipating from God? The anticipation of the anointing of God. That God will bestow his anointing upon you. So when you come to God, come to God. When you come to God, come to him with a lifted voice. And come to God with a mouth of adoration. And when you come to God, come to God with an open heart. And when you come to God, come to God, looking to receive a blessing. As the deer pants, watch this now. As the deer, he pants. As the deer, he pants. His soul was thirsty, which denotes it was sincerity. But the strength of his desire was that he was thirsty, and he will not stop until he gets a drink. He longs for the water of the well of Bethlehem, and nothing was to get in his way. And what he's saying is today, need acts of pure. What he's saying is, I don't need beer or whiskey. What he's saying is, I don't need fruity wine. But the song said, just like a deer, when trouble arises, I got a thirst after God. When problems persist, I got a thirst after God. When discouragement strikes, I got a thirst after God. When depression down your number, I got a trust and thirst after God. When the tears of life roll down your face, it's alright to cry sometimes. It's alright to cry sometimes. Because I heard it in the word he said, that a day will come when he will arise. Every tear from the eyes. Is there anybody in here? You're looking for the Lord to wipe the tears from your eyes. He said, when the tears of life roll, hold on and thirst after God. But watch the psalmist. He had a heavy heart. Feel his plight. I declare today that you're not the only one that's going through. You're not the only one that's dealing with sickness. You're not the only one that's dealing with hurt. You're not the only one that's dealing with trouble and pain. You're not the only one that's dealing with not being able to pay your bills. And the stimulus package, they were running out. But the song that said, verse 42 or chapter 32 and verse 3, he said, my tears have been my food day and night. Well, while people say to me all day long, they ask the question, where he is, your God. Well, I want to encourage you, don't get caught up in what people say. You can listen to the wrong people, and they will give you the improper advice. People told me that I never amounted to anything. People told you that you would be a failure. People said that you can't. But I thank God that God said that I can. As God said that I can be whatever he wants me to be. And watch this. God is still, he's still working on me. And if you hold on to God, and if you keep trusting in God, he'll keep on working on you. The psalmist said in Psalm 22 and verse 4, he said, these things I remember as I pour out my soul. How I used to go to the house of God. best under the protection of the mighty one, with shouts of joy, yes, and praise the number sets the throne, yes. Is there anybody in here, yes, simply get away, yes, from the Lord's house? Is there anybody in here, yes, you better come back, to the Lord's house, to the sanctuary, yes, to lift up all the hands, to lift up your voice with praise. But while you're waiting, let me tell you what to do. Right where you are, lift up all your hands. Right where you are, sing a brand new song. Right where you are, worship and praise the Lord. It does not matter what's going on in your life. Be like Nehemiah and say that the joy of the Lord is my strength. I feel my help beginning to come on in here. So I'm trying to encourage you that there's hope when you wait on God. There's hope when you call on the Lord. And what I want to encourage you is that God is still in charge. God can handle all your problems. God is. God is a way maker. If you know that God is a way maker, let me see you wave, let me see you clap, let me see you get on your feet. I'm gonna pray to me. I'm reminded when I was here of kindergarten that Jesus is honest. She wanna ask anybody in the room. She would say if they're happy and they know it. Clap your hands. Yes. And everybody would clap their hands. She would ask one more time. She said if they're happy and you know it. Stomp your feet. If you're tired in the room, put stomp their feet. But in the last round, she would say if they're happy and you know it, jump for joy, and everybody would start jumping, and if they would stop, but then she came with a caveat on top of an ice cream cone. She said, if they're happy, and you know it, do all three, clap, stop, and jump for joy. If there ain't anybody here, know that God will. If there ain't Jesus
to say that maybe you haven't gone down in the water. Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sin, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. I thank God that he's still in the gift-giving business. Is that you? If you want to repent of your sins and you want to be baptized, inbox us, call us, message us, and make sure that somehow, some way, even in the midst of separation, standing apart, we'll figure out a way to make sure that you get baptized. If that's you, call us. Reach out to us. If you have prayer requests, send them to us. We'll pray for you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I thank God for you. May heaven smile on you is my prayer. Peace.
Say with power and majesty,
power and majesty, dominion.